Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just going to start off. I think Ian gave kind of a bit of an introduction for what I'm going to talk about. He's used environmental layers as a surrogate of diversity. I'm going to look at how we can use other things like spiders themselves, and to what extent birds and maybe trees can also act as surrogates of spider diversity. So spiders are probably the, in South Africa at the moment, it's probably the order, the only megadiverse order that has been sampled quite considerably. There's more than 2,000 species in South Africa, and under the auspices of SANSA, there's been a slew of different studies that's been done by students looking at diversity at point localities, also at regional levels. But even with all these kind of information that we've got, there's still constraints in terms of processing these huge amounts of spiders that we catch. Because, I mean, I'm sure all of you know that if you go out there and you start beating or you start tweet netting, you just get a huge amount of individuals. And so there's a considerable constraint in processing these samples. A lot of these species are undescribed, at least 30% of them are undescribed. There's a lot of juveniles. It's just very difficult to identify a juvenile at the species level. It's poorly known taxonomy. Some of the families are just no-go areas for some people. There are very few professional taxonomists. There's only, in South Africa, there's probably the two really good, there's probably only two or three really good spider taxonomists. And there's no standardized comparative sampling. So the idea, and I think what Ian spoke about, is using environment as a surrogate. What I'm going to talk about is basically using spiders themselves or some other taxon to use as a surrogate. There's certain criteria that a surrogate should have. It should be represent the conservation goals. It should be cost effective. It should be logistically suitable, and it should have good biological efficacy. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. So there's different types of indicators. And so the one that we've got is indicator groups, and this is that classic one that you use. When you do conservation planning, you use the vegetation layer, and it goes into mock sand, and then it gives you the optimal representation of to maximize your conservation effort. Then there is what's called the higher taxon approach. So for spiders, for example, we'll use the genera or the families to represent diversity. And then there's habitat surrogates, and that's something that Ian spoke about in the previous meeting, where you use environmental variables as a surrogate for diversity or for your conservation. Okay, so there's different approaches to applying these surrogates also, and so the one would be richness. So you identify the hotspots for your birds or your trees, and those are the sites you want to conserve. Then there's the complementarity, where you maximize the inclusion of species, phylogenetic, and community across habitats or surrogates. All right, so The focus here is on complementarity, maximizing the beta diversity that you are conserving. And then the other one is another approach that I'm going to talk about is morpho species. And morpho species, basically, it's based on the principle that you can use people that don't know anything about spiders, they can identify these things, and you can use that as a surrogate of diversity. All right. Okay. Surrogate performance should be so when you evaluate a surrogate, it should be congruent with all your biodiversity. Most studies have found no support, has not found support for this assumption, particularly not at finer scales. Okay, and this is where it becomes a little bit more confusing, because these studies are correlated, are either correlated species richness between taxa over grid cells, or assessed overlap of areas selected by a complementarity algorithm for the different taxa. And what can happen with these kind of algorithms is that they look at the overlap of the areas selected, and you can end up with a taxon being a bad surrogate of itself. And so what most of these studies and the methodology that they use is basically they came to the conclusion that surrogacy is not really good. But then I think it's Faith came up with what's called the species accumulation index, and it's pretty much the same as the graph you saw just earlier a while ago. So you've got options. It's not very clear, but at the bottom it says percentage of sites that's selected, and at the top it says percentage of species represented. Okay, and this is the optimal curve. So if you take the actual taxon and you select sites based on complementarity, and they accumulate. So as you go, that is the best curve you can get. So if you select a site using that optimal curve, you will have the best representation of your species. All right, then that is Then you can add what's called a random curve. So what we can do is we can randomly select sites and see how it represents our target taxon. All right, and then you can just that's
very bad, eh?
Anyway, those are the it's kind of a bootstrap process, and so what those little, if you can see it, is the other red the stipple lines. Is they represent the 95% probability, okay? And so you can test if your surrogate performs better than random. All right, so it wouldn't make sense to take something that doesn't perform better than random. You might as well just use randomly selected sites, okay? All right, so that would be, okay, the red, the stippled dark line would be a surrogate that doesn't perform very well. It performs just as well as randomly selected sites. And the black line over there is really good. We can use that surrogate, it would be a really good surrogate for our target taxon, all right? Okay, so these are the distinct. So I've looked at indicated taxon in the form, this is my objective, in the form of cross-taxon surrogates. So specifically looking at woody vegetation and birds, because that's typically what people use for conservation planning. All right, and then higher taxon approach. Yeah, I've focused on genera and families within spiders. I've looked at the genetic features and the families and see how that represents, how it can act as a surrogate. And then also species composition or the allocation of morpho species by non-specialists. So what we did is, I had an MSc student, she basically had no experience with, are you telling me I'm halfway? He's off the area up there. Okay, so I've had this MSc student, I had no experience in identifying spiders, and she identified these spiders and to recognize more taxonomic units, and based on that we then see how she performed. Okay, that is my study site. It's awful. So yeah. So here we go. This is Limpopo, and that is this is basically this area represents the Sopan's bird, and down at the bottom here it's Polokwane. And there was we had four study sites, and it was done at the same time. All these surveys were done at the same time. What I'm going to emphasize here is that we targeted all spiders. We looked at the ground living stuff. We looked at the methods that we use is pitfall sampling. Active searching on the ground, active searching in what we call aerial searching, searching in the trees, we did beating, we did sweeping, and we standardized our sampling according to our and on an hourly basis. So when we had the team consisted of those guys there, and so what we did, we allocated an hour between 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock during the day, allocated a sampling technique to a person, and that person perform that sampling technique for 1 hour. If he had to fix his sweep net or fix his bit, he stopped the stopwatch. And so what we basically want, our sampling unit is based on sampling effort or time, so time spent in the field. Okay, so no, sorry. Let me just give you a quick feedback on terms of how many. So we caught for these three surveys. Let me just go back to that. We had three sites, Bloberg, the Jumon Nature Reserve, Little Lee Farm, and then Polokwane Nature Reserve. And each one of them, we had eight habitat types in each one of those sites. And each one of those sites, we sampled in the area of one hectare using all these methods. Okay. Right, and then what we did is we tried to establish what the relationship is between what happens when you're using bird species richness as a predictor of total spider species richness? And what base comes down to, that's something that I didn't mention. While we were doing this hectare sampling, we also had someone looking for birds. So we had an ornithologist in that 1 hectare area recording birds. And we also had a botanist that recorded all the woody plant species. And so what you basically can see is that there's almost no relationship between bird species richness and spider species richness. And there's also a negative relationship between woody plants and plant species richness and spider species richness. Let me just go back here. Okay, when we look at higher taxa, so when we're using genera, it's pretty clear that genera is quite a good predictor, and that the R squared was 0.95, very good. It starts breaking down when you start using families. Then what we also did is we looked at what's called within taxon surrogacy, and so we use specific families like Tumicidae, there's Tumicids, Saltisidae, and 30D day and RNA day. And so what we did is we first used the first time to establish which family explains the most prime variation. In this instance, it was Tomicidae. And then we add the next species, next family, that would explain even more variation, would add most to the next, to the amount of variation explained, and that was Salticidae. And that's basically the match between them. All right, so it's clear that the combination of Tomicidae and Salticidae is quite a good surrogate for spider diversity, for spider species richness. What you also want to get is you want to get a sense of if this is consistent throughout location. So if you want to, it shouldn't be context specific. So if you sample the one site and you sample the other site, you want your surrogate to perform at the same level. And so what this basically shows is that generic richness performs very well, is not affected by the location that you sample. While family richness is pretty much not very, there's no real strong relationship. This is now for the families, so that's within taxon surrogacy, sorry, cross taxon surrogacy, and it's clear that Tomicidae doesn't perform well, so it's affected by locality, while Tomicidae and Salticidae together is not affected by locality. All right. This is just a Spearman rank correlation, or a Spearman rank a plot of the ranks between the higher taxon and the within taxon surrogates. And it's clear that, once again, Tomicidae and Salticidae together performs very well, while generic much better than just Tomicidae on its own, and that generic rank performs better than for family rank. Okay. Right, so this brings us to what I spoke about just earlier. So the previous one was looking at richness. This looks at complementarity. And so this is called species accumulation indices. And it's pretty much what Ian spoke about also. So what you've got here is that the red curve over there is the random curve, and the stippled red lines is the 95% probabilities. And so if it lies outside that, then outside those, then it's a really kind of good, it performs better than random. So there's the blue line is our optimal curve, and you can clearly see that Salticidae is over here, while Tomicidae does not perform better than random. So Salticidae as a family is then seems to be a very effective surrogate of general total spider diversity. This is for woody plants, and you can see that woody plants perform very badly. They actually do worse than random. While birds didn't do too badly, but it doesn't perform significantly better than random also. Right, and this is for Salticidae, and so if you can look at Salticidae, that's that stippled line over there, and it really performs. It's almost on the optimal curve. So in terms of selecting sites based on complementarity, Salticidae is really kind of a very good, performs very well, while Tomicidae, Tomicidae didn't perform much better than random, and Oxyopidae didn't perform much better either. Okay, and this is just a summary of that table. So it's clearly that genera performs very well. And so SAEON score of 1 means it's really good. 0 means it's pretty bad. And then also there's a significance level associated with it. So it's obvious that genera performs the best, and Salticidae performs the next best. Okay, so just which surrogates are best for spiders? All right, so weak performance of traditional surrogates. So vegetation of birds, and which is typically used in conservation planning, doesn't work very well for spiders. All right. Tomicidae and Salticidae is good predictor of total species richness and ranking of site richness. Tomicidae on its own was affected by survey intensity and geographic location, while there was no such effect on the two family indicator combination of Salticidae and Tomicidae. Genera was the best performing surrogate, even better than Salticidae, but there's certain disadvantages of only using genera. I won't get into that now. And the use of spider morpho species identification, I didn't even mention that. But anyway, so we then also did that. But it should, the cost would be there somewhere. And it performed better than random. But the relationship with species richness wasn't so good. Okay. All right, so I'm just going to quickly go over this. So Tomicidae is a wanderer that are largely foliage dwelling. And there's been a lot of interest in Tomicidae systematics, so its systematics has worked out quite pretty well. And then Salticidae has seen a growth in systematic work, and So we're really building up a lot of taxonomic work that, of these groups, and they've got enormous levels of endemism. It's the family with the highest level of endemism in South Africa. They've got lots of endemic species, and it seems like there's a considerable degree of habitat specialization for these species, and that is considered to be a good criterion for a surrogate. So I would suggest these guys to be good surrogates for spider diversity in general. Okay, I just want to say thanks to all of these people. Or no, they're not even there, but those people that were on the picture, they did most of the work. I just ordered them around. Okay, sure. Cheers.